The Lord said to me, "Go prophesy to the people of Israel. Now therefore, hear the word of the Lord. You say, 'Do not prophesy against Israel, and do not preach against the house of Isaac.' Therefore, thus says the Lord, 'Your wife shall become a prostitute in the city, and your sons and your daughters shall fall by the sword, and your land shall be parceled out by line. You yourself shall die in an unclean land, and Israel shall surely go into exile away from its land.'" Our New Testament lesson today comes from Colossians chapter 1, starting at verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints. Because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, you have heard of this hope before in the word of truth, the gospel that has come to you. Just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learn from Epaphras, our brother and fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, as you bear fruit in every good work, and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints of light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, starting at verse 25. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, giving them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will pay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A couple weeks ago, we had someone in our home to clean the furnace and the air conditioning system. And after he had done that and checking the system, he found that there were a couple things that needed to be repaired. And so he wanted to talk to me about that. Now, my knowledge of such systems is at best a theoretical knowledge. But when he first started talking to me and what needed to be done, I thought I understood what he was saying and was following him. But he continued the conversation and he started getting deeper and deeper into the nitty-gritty. And I realized very quickly I was out of my element, I was over my head, and I did not understand where he was going. It's kind of what happened in our gospel lesson today. There was a lawyer who stood up and asked Jesus a question. He said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus responds with a question. And he said, "How do you read the law? What is your understanding of the law?" And he responds, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your mind, all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus says, "This is a good answer. Do these things and you will live." But the lawyer wanted to justify himself, and so he asked Jesus another question, "And who is my neighbor?" And with this second question, he was out of his element. He went from a general understanding of law, which he possessed, to asking a question of an individual who knew not only the law and understanding of the law, but all the spiritual laws as well, the way God worked, and just about anything else that he needed to know. He was entering a conversation and asking questions with someone where he was definitely out of his element, where he was over his head and he was out of his depth. Jesus, for his part, did something very interesting in answering this lawyer's question. He created this beautiful parable about individuals. He said there was this individual who fell among robbers, and they beat him up and took everything he had and left him for dead. He said first there was a priest who saw what had happened. But when he saw the man, he crossed to the other side of the road and he kept going. Jesus said, then a Levite came and saw the man as well. And he did the same thing. He crossed to the other side of the street and he kept going. It's at this point in the parable that our modern ears in hearing this parable will want to begin to identify the priest and the Levite as the bad guys in the stories, because there's usually bad guys in Jesus' parables and good guys in Jesus' parable. But that's not how the lawyer listening to this parable would have understood it in Jesus' day, nor would most of the people who were listening to this parable. Both the priest and the Levite served in the temple of God, and to do that, they had to remain ritually pure. If this man was already dead and they went over to see if he was all right, they would become ritually impure. And if they had any of his blood on them, they again would become ritually impure. And they would have to go through a purification process that could last days or even up to a week before they could again serve in the temple of God. And it's not really clear whether they would get their apportionment of food and their wages during the time they were ritually impure. So as far as the lawyer knew and the people in Jesus' day, these individuals had a reason, and for them it was a good reason, for avoiding this man and not getting involved. Jesus continues the parable by introducing a third individual who sees this man. And he tells us that he was a Samaritan. And the Samaritan sees this individual and has compassion on him. And he goes over and he gives him first aid. And then he takes him to an inn and takes care of him for the rest of that day. And then he gives the innkeeper money and tells him, "Whatever else you spend taking care of him, I will settle up when I come back." And then Jesus asks the lawyer, "Which of the three was neighbor to the man?" Of course, the lawyer knows the answer. It's the Samaritan. Everybody who's listening to Jesus knows the answer. It's the Samaritan. We know the answer. It's the Samaritan. He's the hero in the story. He's the good guy. But maybe we don't understand, because of our modern times, exactly how much of a hero he was. In this parable, Jesus constructs, he gives each one of these individuals a good reason for not getting involved. And it ends up that the person who helps the Samaritan had the best reason of all those three individuals to simply not be involved with this man. And what was his reason, and why was it so good? Because there was such enmity between Jews and Samaritans in Jesus' day. They were enemies. And so this man he was helping was his enemy. And to get a rough understanding of how strong this enmity and hatred was, there's a modern rabbi who, talking about this parable, Jesus' parable, and the enmity between Jews and Samaritans in Jesus' day, he quipped one day that if that Jewish man had at all been conscious when that Samaritan man came over to help him, he should have rolled down a hill. It would be better to die than to have a Samaritan help you. Of course, he was exaggerating, but we start to get the point of how much they hated each other. So why? Why did they hate each other so much? Well, it went back not a year or 10 years or 50 years or 100 years or several hundred years. It went back about 700 years. Now, that's hard for us in America to realize how people can still be angry and bitter and upset and hate each other after 700 years. But that's exactly what was going on in our gospel lesson. After Solomon died, the kingdom of Israel was split up into the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. They called the northern kingdom Israel and sometimes Samaria, and the southern kingdom was called Judah. 10 tribes went to the north, 2 tribes went to the south. And over the years, sometimes they were allies and sometimes they were at war with each other. But in roughly 722 BC, something very awful happened to the northern kingdom. They were conquered by Sennacherib, king of the Assyrians. Now, the reason they were conquered, according to the prophets, was because they were doing things they weren't supposed to do. And since they were doing things they weren't supposed to do and would not repent, they were conquered. Now, Sennacherib had a policy when he conquered a new nation. He would deport up to 2,000 or 2/3 of the people who were in that country, and he would spread them all over his kingdom. And then he'd take other people from his kingdom and bring them and repopulate that area. Now, his thinking was very straightforward and simple. If the people didn't have a common language, if they didn't have a common history, if they didn't have common customs, if they didn't have a common god or gods, it was much less likely that they would galvanize and seek to overthrow his rule. And it also fostered what he wanted them to get as an identity, which was to be an identity, a person of the empire, rather than of a particular nation. And so when people ask, what happened to the lost tribes of Israel? This is what happened to them. The 10 tribes were lost in this deportation. And all sorts of other individuals were brought into the land. Eventually, the southern kingdom was also deported, but eventually they were brought back. And so there was this division between the two peoples. And there was a rivalry between them about who really were the people of God, who really were following the commands of Moses. Where was the place you were supposed to worship? The Jews, of course, argued that it was in the temple in Jerusalem, and the Samaritans said they had a holy mountain where you should be worshiping. And we see this argument between Jesus and the woman, the Samaritan woman at the well, about these things. There was this enmity between the individuals or the nations that lasted down into the time of Jesus. And so when Jesus constructs this parable, he gives each one of these individuals a reason. And for them, the priest and a Levite, a very good reason. And the Samaritan, the best reason of all in the parable, not to get involved. And yet, that's the one Jesus said is the one who helps. And obviously, Jesus is trying to tell us from God's vantage point who our neighbor is by this parable. In our scripture text today from Amos, we have one of the prophets who was sent to the northern kingdom, who kept warning the northern kingdom that if you don't stop doing things that are sinful, then bad things are going to happen. You're going to be overthrown. Now, why were they doing all these bad things? Well, besides just the general sinful nature of human beings, let's talk about the sinful things they were actually doing. There were cults developing that were worshiping other gods, and sometimes even the king and the queen of the northern kingdom were worshiping other gods. And that was definitely a problem. But there was also another big problem, according to God, as he spoke to the prophets. And that was people were not taking care of one another. They were not seeing each other as neighbor. Now, in the law of Moses, there's a lot of laws that codify things we're not supposed to do to our neighbor, right? You should not kill, you should not steal, you should not commit adultery, you should not bear false witness, on and on, things we shouldn't do to our neighbor. But within the Mosaic law, there are also a whole bunch of laws about things we should do to our neighbor. For example, if you were a landowner and you hired workers in your field, you were supposed to pay those workers at the end of the workday, right then, all the wages that they were due. Now, for a landowner, this is a small thing and something they might even overlook. But for that worker, that was very important because that was the money that would keep them from starving the next day, that worker and his family. And so the law of Moses commanded that you would pay them what you owed them at the end of each workday for their benefit. But at the time of the northern kingdom, rich landowners had started to not worry about paying their laborers at the end of the workday. And they also started cheating the laborers of their wages. And if you were one of those laborers working in the field, what could you do about it? You couldn't do anything about it. So the rich started buying and selling the poor for their own amusement, their own economic gain. There are also all sorts of other laws in the Mosaic Law, things about giving a certain amount of money to the temple so it could be distributed between the widows and the poor and the orphans, and they had stopped doing that. There was a law about not loaning at interest. If your neighbor fell on hard times and needed some money, you were to loan that to them without charging them interest, and they had begun charging interest. Law after law that was in the law of Moses to get them to remember that each other, they're neighbors to each other, and they're supposed to be taking care of one another. They turned their back on it time and time again, and God sent them prophet after prophet telling them, if you keep doing this, very bad things are going to happen. And that's exactly what happened in 722 BC. And there's an interesting connection between our Old Testament lesson from Amos and our gospel lesson today. Because it is the disobedience of the northern kingdom that led to their overthrow. It was the very fact that they didn't recognize each other as neighbor. It's the very fact that they didn't recognize they had an obligation to take care of one another that caused their overthrow, that led to the division between Samaritan and Jew down to Jesus' day. The very disobedience of the northern kingdom and not taking care of their neighbor is the very thing Jesus used in his parable to tell us, in God's eyes, who is our neighbor. And that would be even our worst enemy, even our most hated enemy, even the person that provokes us most, even the person that irritates us most, even the person that we secretly hope bad things happen to. Jesus saying, that is your neighbor. There's a really interesting connection between the fact that the northern kingdom's disobedience in taking care of their own is exactly what led to the thing Jesus used in our gospel lesson to teach us about who is our neighbor. Apparently, God has been working for a very long time to get us to understand who is our neighbor. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the prophets that you sent and the teachers you have given us to help us understand what is truly in your heart. Pray all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A couple weeks ago, we had someone in our home to clean the furnace and the air conditioning system. And after he had done that and checking the system, he found that there were a couple things that needed to be repaired. And so he wanted to talk to me about that. Now, my knowledge of such systems is at best a theoretical knowledge. But when he first started talking to me and what needed to be done, I thought I understood what he was saying and was following him. But he continued the conversation and he started getting deeper and deeper into the nitty-gritty. And I realized very quickly I was out of my element, I was over my head, and I did not understand where he was going. It's kind of what happened in our gospel lesson today. There was a lawyer who stood up and asked Jesus a question. He said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus responds with a question. And he said, "How do you read the law? What is your understanding of the law?" And he responds, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your mind, all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus says, "This is a good answer. Do these things and you will live." But the lawyer wanted to justify himself, and so he asked Jesus another question, "And who is my neighbor?" And with this second question, he was out of his element. He went from a general understanding of law, which he possessed, to asking a question of an individual who knew not only the law and understanding of the law, but all the spiritual laws as well, the way God worked, and just about anything else that he needed to know. He was entering a conversation and asking questions with someone where he was definitely out of his element, where he was over his head and he was out of his depth. Jesus, for his part, did something very interesting in answering this lawyer's question. He created this beautiful parable about individuals. He said there was this individual who fell among robbers, and they beat him up and took everything he had and left him for dead. He said first there was a priest who saw what had happened. But when he saw the man, he crossed to the other side of the road and he kept going. Jesus said, then a Levite came and saw the man as well. And he did the same thing. He crossed to the other side of the street And he kept going. It's at this point in the parable that our modern ears in hearing this parable will want to begin to identify the priest and the Levite as the bad guys in the stories, because there's usually bad guys in Jesus' parables and good guys in Jesus' parable. But that's not how the lawyer listening to this parable would have understood it in Jesus' day, nor would most of the people who were listening to this parable. Both the priest and the Levite served in the temple of God. And to do that, they had to remain ritually pure. If this man was already dead and they went over to see if he was all right, they would become ritually impure. And if they had any of his blood on them, they again would become ritually impure. And they would have to go through a purification process that could last days or even up to a week before they could again serve in the temple of God. And it's not really clear whether they would get their apportionment of food and their wages during the time they were ritually impure. So as far as the lawyer knew and the people in Jesus' day, these individuals had a reason, and for them it was a good reason for avoiding this man and not getting involved. Jesus continues the parable by introducing a third individual who sees this man, and he tells us that he was a Samaritan. And the Samaritan sees this individual and has compassion on him. And he goes over and he gives him first aid. And then he takes him to an inn and takes care of him for the rest of that day. And then he gives the innkeeper money and tells him, whatever else you spend taking care of him, I will settle up when I come back. And then Jesus asks the lawyer, which of the three was neighbor to the man? Of course, the lawyer knows the answer. It's the Samaritan. Everybody who's listening to Jesus knows the answer. It's the Samaritan. We know the answer. It's the Samaritan. He's the hero in the story. He's the good guy. But maybe we don't understand, because of our modern times, exactly how much of a hero he was. In this parable, Jesus constructs, he gives each one of these individuals a good reason for not getting involved. And it ends up that the person who helps the Samaritan had the best reason of all those three individuals to simply not be involved with this man. And what was his reason, and why was it so good? Because there was such enmity between Jews and Samaritans in Jesus' day. They were enemies. And so this man he was helping was his enemy. And to get a rough understanding of how strong this enmity and hatred was, there's a modern rabbi who, talking about this parable, Jesus' parable, and the enmity between Jews and Samaritans in Jesus' day, he quipped one day that if that Jewish man had at all been conscious when that Samaritan man came over to help him, he should have rolled down a hill. It would be better to die than to have a Samaritan help you. Of course, he was exaggerating, but we start to get the point of how much they hated each other. So why? Why did they hate each other so much? Well, it went back not a year or 10 years or 50 years or 100 years or several hundred years. It went back about 700 years. Now, that's hard for us in America to realize how people can still be angry and bitter and upset and hate each other after 700 years. But that's exactly what was going on in our gospel lesson. After Solomon died, the kingdom of Israel was split up into the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. They called the northern kingdom Israel and sometimes Samaria. And the southern kingdom was called Judah. 10 tribes went to the north, 2 tribes went to the south. And over the years, sometimes they were allies and sometimes they were at war with each other. But in roughly 722 BC, something very awful happened to the northern kingdom. They were conquered by Sennacherib, king of the Assyrians. Now, the reason they were conquered, according to the prophets, was because they were doing things they weren't supposed to do. And since they were doing things they weren't supposed to do and would not repent, they were conquered. Now, Sennacherib had a policy when he conquered a new nation. He would deport up to 2,000 or 2/3 of the people who were in that country, and he would spread them all over his kingdom. And then he'd take other people from his kingdom and bring them and repopulate that area. Now, his thinking was very straightforward and simple. If the people didn't have a common language, if they didn't have a common history, if they didn't have common customs, if they didn't have a common god or gods, it was much less likely that they would galvanize and seek to overthrow his rule. And it also fostered what he wanted them to get as an identity, which was to be an identity, a person of the empire, rather than of a particular nation. And so when people ask, what happened to the lost tribes of Israel? This is what happened to them. The 10 tribes were lost in this deportation. And all sorts of other individuals were brought into the land. Eventually, the southern kingdom was also deported, but eventually they were brought back. And so there was this division between the two peoples. And there was a rivalry between them about who really were the people of God. Who really were following the commands of Moses? Where was the place you were supposed to worship? The Jews, of course, argued that it was in the temple in Jerusalem. And the Samaritans said they had a holy mountain where you should be worshiping. And we see this argument between Jesus and the woman, the Samaritan woman at the well, about these things. There was this enmity between the individuals or the nations that lasted down into the time of Jesus. And so when Jesus constructs this parable, he gives each one of these individuals a reason. And for them, the priest and a Levite, a very good reason. And the Samaritan, the best reason of all in the parable, not to get involved. And yet, that's the one Jesus said is the one who helps. And obviously, Jesus is trying to tell us from God's vantage point who our neighbor is by this parable. In our scripture text today from Amos, we have one of the prophets who was sent to the northern kingdom, who kept warning the northern kingdom that if you don't stop doing things that are sinful, then bad things are going to happen. You're going to be overthrown. Now, why were they doing all these bad things? Well, besides just the general sinful nature of human beings, let's talk about the sinful things they were actually doing. There were cults developing that were worshiping other gods. And sometimes even the king and the queen of the northern kingdom were worshiping other gods. And that was definitely a problem. But there was also another big problem, according to God, as he spoke to the prophets. And that was people were not taking care of one another. They were not seeing each other as neighbor. Now, in the law of Moses, there's a lot of laws that codify things we're not supposed to do to our neighbor, right? You should not kill, you should not steal, you should not commit adultery, you should not bear false witness, on and on, things we shouldn't do to our neighbor. But within the Mosaic law, there are also a whole bunch of laws about things we should do to our neighbor. For example, if you were a landowner and you hired workers in your field, you were supposed to pay those workers at the end of the workday, right then, all the wages that they were due. Now, for a landowner, this is a small thing and something they might even overlook. But for that worker, that was very important because that was the money that would keep them from starving the next day, that worker and his family. And so the law of Moses commanded that you would pay them what you owed them at the end of each workday for their benefit. But at the time of the Northern Kingdom, rich landowners had started to not worry about paying their laborers at the end of the workday. And they also started cheating the laborers of their wages. And if you were one of those laborers working in the field, what could you do about it? You couldn't do anything about it. So the rich started buying and selling the poor for their own amusement, their own economic gain. There were also all sorts of other laws in the Mosaic law, things about giving a certain amount of money to the temple so it could be distributed between the widows and the poor and the orphans, and they had stopped doing that. There was a law about not loaning at interest. If your neighbor fell on hard times and needed some money, you were to loan that to them without charging them interest, and they had begun charging interest. Law after law that was in the law of Moses to get them to remember that each other, they're neighbors to each other, and they're supposed to be taking care of one another, they turned their back on it time and time again. And God sent them prophet after prophet, telling them, if you keep doing this, very bad things are going to happen. And that's exactly what happened in 722 BC. And there's an interesting connection between our Old Testament lesson from Amos and our gospel lesson today. Because it is the disobedience of the northern kingdom that led to their overthrow. It was the very fact that they didn't recognize each other as neighbor. It's the very fact that they didn't recognize they had an obligation to take care of one another that caused their overthrow, that led to the division between Samaritan and Jew down to Jesus' day. The very disobedience of the northern kingdom and not taking care of their neighbor is the very thing Jesus used in his parable to tell us, in God's eyes, who is our neighbor. And that would be even our worst enemy, Even our most hated enemy, even the person that provokes us most, even the person that irritates us most, even the person that we secretly hope bad things happen to, Jesus is saying, that is your neighbor. There's a really interesting connection between the fact that the Northern Kingdom's disobedience in taking care of their own is exactly what led to the thing Jesus used in our gospel lesson to teach us about who is our neighbor. Apparently, God has been working for a very long time to get us to understand who is our neighbor. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the prophets that you sent and the teachers you have given us to help us understand what is truly in your heart. Pray all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Please join me in the affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed, found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. A reminder, the boards of the church are meeting tomorrow, session and trustees. And there is an announcement that Fern Elizabeth Coutant, a service of commitment will be held at the chapel grounds of Oaklawn Chapel on Friday, July 19th at 11:30 a.m. And then afterwards, we're going to come back to the church for a luncheon. So be aware of that. Any other announcements? Any prayer requests? Let us gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for coming and teaching us with your own mouth and your own lips, with words that were crafted to cut us to the core and to the heart, and to convict us of the way we live and the things we want and the things we run after, to convict us and to challenge us to live in new ways, to live in service to you and live in service to others. We pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will bless us. You will bless us in mind. You will bless us in heart. So we'll be able to perceive the lessons that you are trying to teach us and the spiritual laws that you were trying to make us aware of and the desires of the very heart of God that you came to share. Pray, Lord God, that by your Spirit you'll open to us a new way of understanding and thinking and being so that we may be your faithful servants in the world. We also pray this day, Lord God, for those we know are going through difficulties and struggles. We pray for Mary, and we pray for Adeline and Dale, and for others. Pray that you'll be with them in a very special way. And now let's take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. God of grace and truth, you fill us with the knowledge of your will, that we may gain spiritual wisdom and understanding. We seek to lead a life worthy of your calling in Christ. We bring you the fruit born of your graciousness, with the prayer that it may be fitting of your blessing and glory. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.